particular chapter, you are going to study about two alcohols, that is ethanol and methanol, as I've told you earlier. Okay, now you all must have studied alcohols in your syllabus, right? In your chemistry, maybe you all must have used alcohols in your laboratories many times, right? Okay, so now in laboratory, the alcohol which you used is probably ethanol, right? Now on the bottle, simply it is written alcohol. All right. So now when it is unclassified, that is when you simply say alcohol, it refers to ethanol. Okay. So now you know about the structure of alcohol. I need not go into detail here. They have just mentioned one statement here: hydroxyacetals of the aliphatic hydrocarbons. That is, there are carbon atoms and there are hydrogen atoms, and the functional group on this particular compound is OH group. So that makes it an alcohol. So now, depending upon the number of carbon atoms, you are already aware of it. That depending upon the number of carbon atoms, the alcohols, there are many types of alcohols: methanol, ethanol, propanol, butanol, isopropanol, isobutanol, and so on, depending upon the structure and the arrangement of the atoms. Okay. So now in this particular subject, pharmacology, for us, these two alcohols are more important. Now, why do we need to study these alcohols in our syllabus? Is it a drug? Is it used for any treatment of any disease or something like that? Is it? You all can unmute and talk. Yes.
No, ma'am.
No, it is not a drug, right? It is not used for treatment of any particular disease or any particular condition, right? So why do we need to study these alcohols in our syllabus? Okay, so that's because alcohols, these are present in the beverages which are consumed by the people. Alcoholism is seen because many people consume alcohol for maybe pleasurable effect, to derive a sense of well-being, euphoria, and so on. Also, alcohol is a very important solvent which is used in certain medicated preparations. You must have prepared in your laboratories. Maybe it is for internal use, or maybe it is for the external use also. Say, for example, astringents are there, then disinfectants are there. These are quite used quite commonly. Okay, and nowadays in this pandemic situation, you all are aware of the sanitizers. It is a part and parcel of our life. Right, so it contains alcohol basically. That's how the microorganisms on the surface, it can be killed. Okay, so that's how, or that is the importance of alcohol, and that's basically why you need to know what is this alcohol, what happens when it is consumed, what effects are shown on our body. Okay, so to start with, there is a brief introduction about this ethyl alcohol. As I've told you, this chapter is divided into two, that is ethyl alcohol and methyl alcohol. Okay, that is ethanol and methanol. So first we are going to start with the ethanol. Okay, so in the introduction, briefly they have told how this alcohol is produced. It is basically produced by the fermentation, okay, of the sugars. The commercial source of alcohol, it is molasses, which is a byproduct of the sugar industry. Okay, that is sugar is produced from the sugar cane. So molasses is actually a byproduct. So from this, alcohol is actually produced, which is supplied commercially. And alcohol, when it is supplied, it needs license and all that. Anyone cannot possess the alcohol. In your jurisprudence subject also, you will study about all this. Now again, they have told about the alcoholic beverages which are consumed by people nowadays. Okay, and the content of the alcohol. Well, this is not important for us. Okay, so I'll just skip that. You all can go through. Okay, now alcohol consumption, that is ethanol, is consumed actually, but then methanol can be mixed. All right. So methanol can be mixed. Maybe purposefully someone may mix it, you know, for adulteration purpose, or purposefully someone may mix it, or accidentally someone may consume it, or deliberately someone may ask this particular person to consume this particular alcohol, which is unfit for drinking. I'm talking about the methyl alcohol. It is poisonous in nature. So as I told you yesterday also, that is methanol is only of toxicological importance. It is not consumed. It is ethanol that can be consumed. Okay. Now to start with the first point under our summary, as I was talking about, I had shown you all a summary also yesterday. So we are going to start with the first point, that is pharmacological actions. Okay. So coming to the pharmacological actions of ethanol, these are also very important from exam point of view. There was a question specifically on pharmacological actions of ethanol also in your exam, maybe periodic exam, maybe your semester exam. Okay, so both exam point of view, it is important. Okay, so we'll start with the pharmacological action. So the first point under this is the local actions. That is, local action meaning what? There are two types of actions, right? Local action and systemic action. Okay, systemic action meaning actions which are produced once the drug or a substance is in your blood circulation. So it will get distributed throughout your body and it will start producing actions internally into your systems of the body. Whereas local action meaning what? It is the action produced at a restricted area. Okay, that means a local action. Systemic action meaning actions which are shown throughout your body. Okay, or general actions. So coming to the local action. So what will happen if that alcohol is applied locally or superficially? What are the types of actions? Okay, you all have studied about the route of administration, local routes and the systemic routes. So it is discussed in somewhat in that line. So local action, that is after application or after superficial injection of this alcohol, what are the types of effects which can be produced? Okay, so coming to the first local action, it is acting as a rubefacient and counter irritant. So once you apply or rub it onto a skin, okay, you all must have come across this in your laboratories also. If the alcohol spills on your hands, okay, on the surface of your skin, it gives a cooling sensation. Okay, right? So that's the next action because of the evaporation. It is volatile in nature, you must have seen. You should not leave the bottles open because it will evaporate. So once it falls on your skin, immediately it will start evaporating and it will give a cooling sensation. Alright. And apart from that, if you rub it onto a skin, it will produce a mild rubefacient and counter-irritant action. Rubefacient meaning it will produce vasodilatation in that particular area. Okay. And it will start increases the blood circulation in that particular area. Okay. Vasodilatation, that is the blood vessels, it will get dilated. It will become bigger in size. So if the diameter of the blood vessels will increase, what will happen? Okay. The blood flow to that particular area will increase. Okay. Then the next action, local action is counter irritant. That is, it will produce irritation in that particular area. Now, what is the purpose of this? This irritation is produced in one particular area to reduce the irritation maybe in some other part of the body. Okay, so it will get diverted to some other area. So that's how it will start reducing the irritation which may be produced in maybe some pathological area of the body. So this is one of the important local action of the alcohol. Then this is very important. Application to the delicate scenes. Say for example, the mucous membrane, maybe of the nose or near your eyes. You are supposed to avoid the application of alcohol around your eyes or into your nasal mucosa. These are delicate. Your skin has a protective layer, right? Okay, it is keratinized. Okay, it consists of the dead cells. But the mucus, it is not well protected. So once you apply this alcohol onto the delicate skin or onto the mucous membranes, it will start producing the burning sensation or it will start producing the irritation in that particular area. So you should avoid the contact of this alcohol with your mouth or with your nose, okay, or nasal mucosa and so on. Then next action produced when it is injected by the subcutaneous route. It will produce intense pain and inflammation in that particular area and the tissues where it is injected. It may start damaging the tissue so that the fibrosis, okay, you're aware of this, right? Fibrosis in the inflammatory process or damage or tissue damage process, you almost have studied about this. Tissue necrosis, tissue start drying and fibrosis, that is scar formation will take place in that particular area. Then when you inject this alcohol around a nerve, as you're aware, the nervous system It is present throughout your body. Each and every part of your body receives the nervous supply. So if you inject this particular alcohol around a particular nerve, it can permanently damage that particular neuron. And neurons, you all are already aware of that the nervous function cannot be regained. Once the nerve is damaged, the damage is a permanent damage. The nerves do not gain their function back, or they do not regenerate like other cells of our body. So if your skin is cut, what happens? After a few days, it will repair and the new cells will start forming and that area will get covered with the fresh skin, right? But that doesn't take place in case of your neurons. So once the neurons are damaged, it's a permanent damage. So injection around a particular nerve may damage that particular nerve. Okay, then this is one more important property. Alcohols, they have astringent property. What do you mean by astringent? You have already studied about this. Meaning the surface proteins will get precipitated in a particular area. You must have prepared aftershave lotions in your laboratories as your practicals. Have you all? Yes or no? Unmute yourselves and answer. I don't want it as a monotonous world. I need your replies. You all have prepared, right? Astringents by using alcohols. Okay. So alcohol, they have astringent property. That is, they can precipitate the surface proteins and hardening of the skin may take place. So that's how they are acting as the astringent. So alcohol you will find in the preparations like aftershave lotion. Okay. So it can reduce the irritation by precipitation in that particular area. Also, alcohol is acting as an antiseptic by precipitating the bacterial proteins. So it can kill the bacteria by precipitating the proteins in that particular bacteria. However, spores cannot be affected, and this particular antiseptic action go on increasing as you increase the concentration of alcohol from 20 to 70%. As you go higher and higher, it will go on increasing the antiseptic property, but the property remains constant from the 70 to 90%. So if you all must be aware of that 70% of alcohol is sufficient to kill the microbes. So antiseptics generally contain the alcohol roughly about, say, 70% of the alcohol. Okay. The next, this is very important. Okay. So this focuses on your main chapter, that is drugs which are acting on the CNS. So alcohol can also affect your CNS. Basically, it is a depressant substance. Okay, so it will depress your CNS. Okay, so you must have seen the drunkard people. What happens in them? They are drowsy, they are sloppy. You will find some people who are lying down on the floors, right? Okay, they are not able to speak properly, or they are not able to produce, or they are not able to perform any kind of function, correct? So they are lying down, some people are unconscious. So all these happens because of the actions of alcohol on the CNS. Okay. Now there are various types of actions produced depending upon the amount of alcohol which is present in your blood. That is the actions or the outcomes of the behavior of a person, or the outcomes of the action on the CNS, it depends upon how much alcohol is consumed by that particular person. So here you can see in the brackets, the concentration of alcohol is given. Okay, that is at a particular concentration, these are the effects which can be seen. Okay, so now to start with, basically alcohol is a depressant one. So it is a neuronal depressant drug, so it will produce depression of your CNS. But when you look at a person who is consuming alcohol, initially the excitation will be seen, or the excitement will be seen. If you see the person who is having moderate amount of alcohols, the person will become more talkative or more excited, or the person may gain euphoria, that is a sense of well-being. Okay, so this happens at low concentrations, that is 30 to 60 milligrams per deciliter. So your hesitation is, it is lost, the fatigue or the anxiety, okay, that is fear, that is allied. The person will not have control over the thoughts and the person will not hesitate. Now generally, when you are in a, social appearance, your behavior tends to be certain reserved one, right? You know how to behave socially when you are in between 100 people. But if you see a drunkard person, the person will not know how to behave. The person will go on speaking any rubbish, will behave anyhow. That's because hesitation, conscience, and self-criticism all are lost, or they are alive. Okay, so this is what has happened initially when the person is having low concentrations of alcohol. Now, why this initial excitement takes place is, and later on as you go higher concentration, the depressive actions are more prominent. Now, why this takes place is because alcohol, when it acts on the brain, okay, there are two types of areas in the brain. Excitatory areas are there, and certain areas are inhibitory in nature. You all have already studied CNS in your anatomy, right? Okay, so certain areas, when they are stimulated, okay, they will produce the excitatory effect. That is, a person's mood will be very high, will be very, you know, talkative or alert or active. Okay, and there are certain areas in the brain which are inhibitory in nature. That is, when these areas are stimulated, the person will tend to become calm and quiet, or the activities may get reduced. Okay, so these are the two types in which you can broadly classify the brain areas. I'm not going into the actual anatomy of the brain, but basically certain areas are responsible for the excitatory action, and the certain areas of your brain are responsible for the inhibitory action or the suppressive action. Okay, now what alcohol is doing is, okay, if you can see that the higher area, these are deranged initially. Okay, so higher areas, these are generally inhibitory in nature. Okay, or these are suppressive in nature. So the person will become calm and quiet by stimulation of these inhibitory areas of the brain. Okay, so what alcohol is doing? It is depressing these inhibitory areas at the low concentration. So what will be the outcome? It will be excitation. So inhibitory areas are inhibited or depressed. So it will result into excitation. So since higher areas are inhibitory areas, and higher areas are depressed first by the alcohol at low concentrations, initially excitation may be seen. That's how the person will become more active, will start moving here and there, will not hesitate, will talk. Okay, so all such behavior is seen initially at low concentration of alcohol. However, as the concentration of alcohol goes higher, the excitatory areas of the brain are also getting affected. So they are also getting depressed. Okay, so because of this depression of excitatory areas, later on, depression will be shown. Okay, so the person may become sloppy, will become ataxic, that is, the motor incoordination will be seen, as the person will not be able to control the muscular movement, will not be able to speak properly, will not be able to walk properly or stand properly, and the person may also become unconscious also at times. So this is what is happening at the later stage. Okay, so as we go higher, okay, so that is at 80 to 150 milligrams per deciliter. So as you increase the concentration of alcohol, so as the consumption increases, the mental clouding or disorganization of the thought, or impairment of the behavior, or the control over the your muscular movement or your position, gait, okay, alteration of the gait, that is the way you stand up and so on. Okay, perception and drowsiness will be produced at the higher concentration. So person will not be able to walk properly or think coherently or judge properly. Okay, so at the higher concentration, and if you go still higher, that is 150 to 200 milligrams per deciliter, the person is sloppy, ataxic, that is, motor coordination is lost, and the person may not be able to walk properly. Blackouts may be seen at times, that is, the person may go blank. Okay, and at still higher doses, that is 200 to 300 milligrams per deciliter, stupor, that is, a person will lie down flat, okay, or unconscious, and at still higher doses, the person may even die, okay, due to the mental actions or due to the CNS actions. Okay, so overall, if you can see that initial excitation is seen, and later on the depressive actions are seen, but overall, if you see the action of the alcohol on CNS is a depressive one. Person will become drowsy, skillful performances will get affected. So driving is dangerous, to perform on a particular machine is dangerous, accidents may take place. So it is advised, even on the medications it is written that it is dangerous to drive while on this particular medication or to perform any operations on the machines. Okay, because of drowsiness you may lose the perception and accidents may take place. Okay, so that's how it should be avoided. Then hangover is another problem with alcohol. The next day when you wake up, all the adverse effects will be seen. Okay, mood will be impaired. Okay, then you may not be able to think coherently. Headache may be seen, dryness of mouth may be produced, dizziness, that is you may start losing consciousness and you may not able to stand appropriately. So that is hangover. Okay, apart from that, alcohol also induces sleep. Okay, that it has sedative action, it can induce sleep, it can raise the pain threshold, that is it has analgesic property also, and it also has anticonvulsant property also. Okay, it can control the seizures or convulsions, okay, epileptic attacks. However, all these three are not reliable actions, so alcohol is not preferred for this particular type of action. You cannot use as an analgesic or in the treatment of convulsion and so on. Okay, because at times it can raise the seizure threshold and epileptic attacks may get precipitated, or painful sensation may itself be induced by the alcohol. So it's not a reliable. Then coming to the mechanism of action, now this mechanism is pertaining to the actions of alcohol on the CNS. So by what mechanism exactly it is producing all these actions on the CNS? Now if you can see, there are number of mechanisms by which the alcohol is acting. Okay, the first one is it is promoting the GABA release. GABA is gamma amino butyric acid. It's an inhibitory transmitter, so its release is promoted and it will suppress the stimulation of the neurons. Another mechanism is it inhibits the NMDA, which is a excitatory type of amino acid receptor, so that is suppressed. Another mechanism says that the action of 5-HT, that is serotonin or 5-hydroxytryptamine, its action on the receptor, that is 5-HT3 receptor. Okay, this is actually a inhibitory receptor, and the action of 5-HT on 5-HT3 receptors is augmented, that is it is promoted. This also you all are going to study in detail under autocoid chapter. Then another mechanism is it acts on the nicotinic cholinergic receptors in the CNS. This could also be one of the target. Then also ethanol is acting on the calcium channels. Voltage sensitive calcium channels are suppressed or they are inhibited in the CNS. Another mechanism also says that it can activate the potassium ion channels in the brain in certain areas. Then apart from this, it can also act by increasing the release and turnover, that is synthesis of the dopamine. Dopamine also is one of the catecholamine. You all have already studied this under the adrenergic system. Okay, drugs acting on the adrenergic system. Dopamine is one of the catecholamine which is playing a very important physiological role. Specifically, dopamine over here will give the reward function. That is, the sense of well-being is produced because of this dopamine. Okay. Another mechanism says it can alter the enzymes like sodium potassium, ATPase or adenylyl cyclase, which is again a part of GPCR, which you all have studied. Okay, this function of these enzymes, specific enzymes could be altered. Again, protein kinases or function also is altered, so that phosphorylation of certain endogenous molecules will get affected, so that the functioning or physiology of the brain may get affected. So these are the different mechanisms by which alcohol is acting in the CNS. So multiple mechanisms are there. Maybe these particular actions produce different facets of actions which we have seen. There are a number of actions we have seen under the CNS. So each one could be mediated by various types of actions which are produced at different molecular level, with the actions produced